the Back to Nature exhibit area had to come out due to its age, we started to talk about what could replace it. And the concept of a whale started to feel that need of people asking about the giants of Maine, because we did the program with the giants of Maine related to the paleo giants. And then the whale always came up as part of that discussion because it's an animal that is still alive today. Having a whale named Vector and knowing who she was and how she interacted with the world just was really exciting. And then in addition to that, Dan offered the possibility for us to get a calf. Now, it's not necessarily Vector's calf, but even if it's not, it's one of the life moments that she had.
So what you're trying to do is get that balance between clean,
yeah,
clean beautiful,
yeah,
pristine, yeah, bones that, yeah, you want to present and not compromising,
right,
them.
Right.
The vertebrae for Vector weigh in the, some of them are as many as 30 pounds a piece. They range from about a dozen to 30 pounds. And so that's a thing that we're manipulating and moving around, using a big drill on and that sort of thing.
Dan, I actually met through the Park Service. He was mounting, I think, an 18-foot whale for the Park Service and basically found out that he was a part of Whales and Nails, that he also was working with live whales, and that that's what his doctoral research was in. And from that point on, we just continued to have a conversation about whales and how I would love to see one displayed at the Maine State Museum, because there's so many stories to be told from that point of entry.
Many of these bones are actually individual bones of the skull. These are the nasal bones of the skull, and then there's a little pocket right in there where they just slip up, slip into place. This actually being the blowhole here, left and right.
And Dan, true to his word, kept us in mind every time there was a whale stranding or an animal that he felt we could act on. He would give us a heads up so that we could see whether it was something that we could acquire.
She's a Western North Atlantic Gulf of Maine whale, and most of her life she spent her summers off of Cape Cod in the Gulf of Maine, and that's where we collected her. She was dead on that beach.
So humpback whales have been one of the most studied groups because their flukes, they started to do a catalog where they actually took photos of flukes and were able to re-identify whales as they surfaced on their migratory routes. And Vector, I think, was originally named and added to the catalog in 1984. So we actually have a lot of her biology in the sense that we know where she migrated to and from, and that she had 5 calves in her lifetime. The calf itself is an unnamed individual because it died before it had an individualized fluke in order to have the identifying characteristics. Basically, the calf was too young. Related to humpback whales, we understand that they have a very long migration route that goes all the way down to the Caribbean.
And that makes sense if you're just looking at the ocean and trying to figure out where we go. The idea is that the calves are vulnerable to all kinds of predation, and they have a thermal disadvantage to those high latitudes that the animals feed at, which drives this migratory lifestyle. And so that the moms are going down to find shallow, predator-free waters to calve in that are easy for the calf.
And then they come back up for the food resources that are here in the Gulf of Maine. And I know that Vector was well known, and people knew her by name, and they would report her when they saw her fluke. And that is the kinds of individual information that we can gather about these animals. Individual people in our society being interested enough to whale watch and report what they see. All marine mammals are protected under NOAA, and you cannot act or touch an animal without being the proper authorized individuals or having the proper permits. There's many reasons that whales die, but often they get washed onto a beach, but initially they're found out to sea. And you have the problem of having a 45-ton animal needing to be moved off of a beach. Necropsies are usually started or done on the shoreline where the animal is brought in. In order to preserve a skeleton, you need to move the animal to a place where you can hand render the material. When you use heavy equipment, some of the bones are fragile enough that they get lost in the process. So one of the things that Dan DenDanto does is he has an area that he brings whales to work on that rendering process. He brings the partially defleshed material to the property. I believe he covers it in wood chips, and then he monitors how well it is being defleshed so that he can take the bone out at an optimum time. All the bones need to be inventoried and tracked. That's part of the requirement for NOAA, because this is a specimen that is under permit, and the museum itself had to apply for permits in order to display the whales. And once that inventory is done, then you take a good hard look at the animal to see whether it is a mountable specimen. If the rendering was done carefully and well, then you should have most of the bones in a viable condition such that you can begin the process of cleaning them up. And once the flesh is off, the things that you need to know about whale bones is they're full of oil. And Dan has come up with a technique, a water bath technique, where you basically can sink the bones into a particular temperature of water bath, and that causes the fats and the oils to basically lift out. Those oils, which would be a risk if a specimen gets mounted to the animal being invaded by insects or other issues, or dripping, where oil might drip from a specimen.
The reason we can drill these things out now and it becomes an extra good idea is I can get a sort of an assessment of how much grease is deep in the bone before I go. It will come out.
Yeah, that's yeah, drilled that's with a 4-inch hole saw, yeah. And that's the steel pipe that'll support the mother whale. So again, they'll be in here for 2 or 3 days, and then they come out and they use a power spray.
It's a messy operation when this goes, and it's obviously a steamy operation. We're okay to have that moisture in this particular space. And this is what happens when I said I like that water and I like the smell of it. That's the color coming out of the bones. That was in the bones, it's not in the bones. I tell everybody, bone is bone color. It's an off-white color. And the other stuff that's in there is stuff that's growing on it. Perhaps it's leftover proteins. I do this not until the water is clean, 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 but until I'm convinced and I've got enough experience that that's gonna clean up with the peroxide. And so, but I can already tell, this would you would not have been able to see through that water on the first couple of baths as it richens up. And it puts an aroma in.
And once those oils are cleared out, then there's a process of doing the math to know the weight of the specimen and how you're going to be able to mount it. And luckily with Dan, with Whales and Nails, that's all part of his passion and all part of his training that he had as he was coming up through the ranks and ended up being a scientist. But he was involved in mountings early and learned the stress and the physics of what it would take to mount a specimen. And some of the bones you'll find are drilled so that pipes can be run through the middle. And there's cable attachment points.
Our intent is for the steel structure to be blind to us. We don't want to see, we just want to see the whale, not the structure. And so that's the objective there, and gets us into this destructive sort of mount where you're drilling out this center. But again, that's where the big oil reserve is. Usually drilling the spine out. We're just about to start that for the calf. Then we'll go back and we'll glue the things on that are falling off. In this case, we have the fragments. They all came off cleanly. I was there when they took this animal apart. And I won't say we're not missing, you know, something. So these kind of damages here are often done. And you can see they just happen to be 3 in a row. And so I can just tell you from experience, yeah, that's when the excavator grabbed the tail and rolled it over, because they were like, can we get to the other side of it? So that sort of stuff happens on the beach, and this is the likely result. But as you can see, the margins of the breaks are clean. And so these will go back together pretty painlessly. This isn't necessarily the right one, but there would be some sort of intervening steel post. And then the next section is the thoracic vertebrae. These are easy to denote because they all have a facet on the end of the transverse process. This is the attachment point for the rib. With a big whale like this, I tend to put in a pipe receiver in this end. And then what I have is a rod on the rib side, and so that it goes into a sleeved metal. So that way when the wind, it's a bit, essentially a cantilever, but the cantilever is not acting at the end of the rod on a point in the bone, it's inside a steel sleeve, distributing that, you know, pressure to the hole so that you don't get an undue force. These will essentially go from a rack to this and on to its armature. The armature is thought out for how it will break apart. We obviously won't be bringing in a 45-foot long spine. It'll be in sections 10 to 12 feet at a chunk, though the skull is a good dozen feet long, so that'll be the largest single piece.
And if we're lucky, Dan has committed to helping us actually mount the baleen back into the mouth of the whale so that people can get a better understanding of how baleen feeding whales actually live and process food in their environment.
So you can go down through these sort of striations that you see on the plate here, yeah, and you can sample this for different time periods in her life and go back and look at whether it was radioisotope had been direct to her diet. So 300-400 of these on either side, the two girls over here, they create effectively a net. You can see how a fish isn't going to get through that. These are gulp feeders, so they're bulk gulping water and fish, and then they force it out. It's a really pretty energetic feeding system.
Are we going to put all of those back into the mouth?
That's the plan.
That's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot, and it's a lot of weight. There's some engineering considerations.
Wow.
It will be a detachable set. It will not be glued to the skull. Okay. It will be mechanically bolted to the skull.
One of the interesting things that Dan spoke about was how different it was to deal with the calf, because the calf is not mineralized at all to the level of an adult, and so the processing is very different. It's actually a very fragile kind of skeleton, and it's way lighter than the adult, and so he had to modify his techniques in order to properly process the calf. And these are all actually exciting behind-the-scenes things that museum personnel get to learn about. As they witness someone's passion for bringing these animals to life.
To scientists by photo ID record, she, I think her death or collection date was around the May 20th of 2012 or somewhere in that. She was a calf of the year, so she could have been born anywhere from late December to February or even early March of that year. So she was just a couple months old. So what we have here from a growth perspective is the epiphyseal discs, which is the growth plate on the margin. So these things would grow in all directions, but this is where the growth is occurring between these things. And the process of them becoming fused is called ankylosis. Osteological maturity has to do with when ankylosis is complete. And that actually occurs pretty late in life. And in all mammals, it appears to start at the ends of the animal and work inwards towards the middle, so that the lumbar vertebrae are the ones that are less likely to be ossified. So depending on if you get one of these middle-aged animals, you can find an animal where many of the discs are fused. I believe they're all fused on vector. Look here, this is the end of the thorax going into the lumbar. Is they're not attached, they're not attached, and then they're attached, and stuff like that. And so this was caught just right in that middle, whatever that sweet spot is, 4 to 6 months of age, where those bones had not even fused. Our intention here then is to leave that gap. These are small and fragile, and we want to drill through them. We want to drill through cleanly and have the hole being through all of the areas. This is, I'm into the canned cellulose layer in there. This was just the epiphyseal disc that's removed, was glued on. So now I have a center hole here. But as you can see here, there's a lot of handle of the bone, and this is all of the stuff that's antagonistic once we've cleaned this with peroxide. So often I'll have to break these into several pieces like this to get the core out, and then I can continue on in the same direction or whatever, and I won't have to go far because I see I have almost gone through. But sometimes it drags a little bit. I'm using a variable speed though, so then I took it out, and then just like pulling the core out of a pineapple. Again, I'm looking for this dust. doesn't feel waxy or lipid in it or any kind of odor or any of that sort of stuff coming out. So that went really quick. And the one thing that I'll say, they did not go quick like that with Vector, and it really has to do with the density of the bones from ossification. And so there was a lot of swinging of a much heavier hammer out, you know, and it was a work day. How many days do you think you worked on that? Was it three? Two, four days. 4 days to drill out that 20.
And in the case of the displays I've seen created by Dan, there's the beauty of him understanding the living animals such that he tries to mount the skeleton in a way that you can see some of that life still in the specimen. And so I think being able to have this specimen from beginning to end properly cared for and shepherded through the process, Vector will be coming to the museum in the best situation possible.